Let us look at a quadratic polynomial from a dynamical point of view. Every quadratic polynomial is conjugate by a membrane transformation through a unique map of the quadrant square plus t. The junior set of a map is the boundary of the set of all the points with bounded orbit. For example, if we take a point inside the unit disk for the map that goes to the square, then its orbit converges to zero because the absolute value decreases exponentially fast. And such orbit is stable under small perturbation. So if we slightly move the point, then the orbit doesn't change much. Similarly, if we take an orbit outside of the unit disk, then its orbit converges to infinity. Such orbit is again stable. If we slightly move the point, then the orbit doesn't change much. However, if we take a point on the unit circle, then its orbit is usually chaotic and it's unstable under small perturbation. So the same story happens with any map. So the black set here is the set of points that do not escape to infinity under the iteration. And if we take a point inside the non-escaping set, then its orbit is stable and it converges to 0 minus 1 cycle for this map. But if we take a point on the boundary, then its orbit is usually chaotic and unstable under small perturbation. So this means that to understand the dynamical system, we need to understand its junior set. There are two possibilities. Either the junior set is connected, or it is a counter set. The Mandelbrot set is the set of parameters whose junior set is connected. The Mandelbrot set is a parameter, a counterpart of the junior set, meaning that the dynamical system is stable under small perturbation of a parameter. Equivalently, the junior set is stable under small perturbation of a parameter. If and only if the parameter is not on the boundary of the Mandelbrot set. For the parameter C equal to zero, the junior set is the unit circle. If we slightly move the parameter, then the junior set is still topologically a circle, but it is a distorted circle. The distortion is big when we are close to the boundary. And if we cross the boundary, the junior set changes. So here the junior set is a counter set because we are outside of the Mandelbrot set. Here the junior set is connected, but it is not a circle, so it has countably many cut points. And here the junior set is a counter set and it is quite visible. So the same analysis can be done for other one-dimensional parameter spaces. Here we see a parameter slice in cubic polynomials, a parameter slice in quadratic rational maps. This is the space of cubic Newton maps, and this is a transcendental sign family. A common feature of these parameter spaces is that they all contain many copies of the Mandelbrot set. For example, here, 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 and here. So if we zoom in, then we see copies of the Mandelbrot set. So the Mandelbrot set is everywhere when it comes to complex dynamics. In particular, the Mandelbrot set contains infinitely many copies of itself. Douady and J, Hubbard proved that every copy is indeed canonically homeomorphic to the Mandelbrot set. So here there are four copies of the Mandelbrot set from different parts of the Mandelbrot set. So and if you zoom in, then yeah, we see that this is almost true copies of the Mandelbrot set. Such copy is called primitive. So a primitive copy is a copy that has a cusp. This copy don't have a cusp. So such copy is called a satellite copy. So the main conjecture on the Mandelbrot set is the MSC conjecture, saying that the Mandelbrot set is locally connected. It means that topologically the Mandelbrot set is simple. Meaning that the MSC is equivalent to the property that the Mandelbrot set is a continuous image of the closed unit disk. So the closed unit disk is obviously locally connected. And a continuous image of the closed unit disk is again locally connected. If the MLC conjecture holds, then the Mandelbrot set is a continuous image of the closed unit disk. And moreover, this map could be chosen very explicitly. We draw counter-Riemannian curves in the closed unit disk in a prescribed manner. So we connect 1/3 and 2/3. So there should be a curve. So this curve corresponds to this cut point. So we connect 1/7 and 2/7. This curve corresponds to this cut point. 5/6 and 6/7 correspond to this cut point. And so on. So after that, we take the closure and collapse all curves. So the result is the Mandelbrot set, provided that the MSC holds. So this particular model is called a pinch disk model of the Mandelbrot set. So the MSC conjecture has been intensively studied.
Well, you don't know that there is such a map, but you know all these particular things about it.
Right, yeah. So if right. So if the MLC doesn't hold, then we still can define this pinch model of the Mandelbrot set by considering the closed unit disk and collapsing all curves, and then there would be a continuous map from the Mandelbrot set to the abstract model, and this continuous map collapses all regions where MLC fails. So roughly speaking, if the fibers of continuous map Mandelbrot set to its abstract model exactly where MST fails. But yeah, so all people believe that the MST holds. So Jean-Christophe Jacquot proved that Mandelbrot set is locally connected at non-infinitely normalizable parameters. These are parameters that belong to at most finitely many copies of the Mandelbrot set. As a corollary, the MLC conjecture...
Finitely what?
Copies of the Mandelbrot set.
Components?
Copies. Small copies.
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 Oh, copies. Okay. Yeah, finitely copies, okay.
As a corollary, we can reformulate the MLC conjecture in the following way. So consider a small copy of the Mandelbrot set, for example, here. And let us consider the canonical homeomorphism from this copy to the main Mandelbrot set. Now, if this canonical homeomorphism is topologically expanding in the sense that the inverse images of the Mandelbrot set shrink to a singleton, then the Mandelbrot set is locally connected at this particular parameter. So the full conjecture is equivalent to a simultaneous expansion of all canonical homeomorphisms. Namely, consider the union of all maximum small copies of the Mandelbrot set.
So expanding in the topological sense?
Yes. And consider a map that maps each copy to the Mandelbrot set canonically. Now the MLC conjecture is equivalent to the property that every component of the non-escaping set is a singleton. So this means that the Mandelbrot set shrinks under backward iteration of this map with respect to all possible branches. So this particular case is a periodic case, when the itinerary of a point is periodic. For simplicity, I will often restrict the attention to this periodic case. So, but in general, we also wanted to have some kind of uniform control around periodic points. So this is a reformulation of the MSC conjecture thanks to Jan-Christoph-Jakob's results. It was proven by Lyubich, and she did benefit by Grachuk and Stratek, that the MSC holds on the real line. Meaning that if we consider the intersection is the real line, then it's a singleton. So the full version says that every component of this set intersected with the real line is either a singleton or empty.
What's the year of that result?
I think 1990s.
1990s?
Yeah, 1997.
You're formulating a little bit stronger results than we actually did, so.
Okay, sorry, yeah.
Okay.
Jeremy Kahn and Misha Lyubich showed that the canonical homeomorphism are simultaneously expanding if small copies of the Mandelbrot set are epsilon away from the molecule. So a molecule is the main cluster of closed components in the center of the Mandelbrot set. So this is the molecule. So it consists of the main component, all components that touch the main component, all components that touch the main components, and so on. So the molecule stops somewhere here, and so on. So outside of the molecule, all maximal small copies of the Mandelbrot set are primitive, so maximal copies have a cusp. And in particular, if you take such primitive copy and map it canonically to the main Mandelbrot set, then the non-escaping set consists of a singleton.
Why isn't everything part of the molecule?
Sorry?
Why isn't everything part of the molecule?
Well, because there is sort of kind of arc. So this particular component is connected to this one through kind of quantumly many arcs.
So it has to be like,
yeah.
No arcs.
There's no homeomorphic copies of the Mandelbrot set containing that last small orange one with something far out.
Okay.
There's something connecting them, but they're not homeomorphic to this Mandelbrot.
So roughly speaking, so here the behavior of the Mandelbrot set is that there are closed balls that shrink, and then the Mandelbrot set kind of continues. So and then this is a part of the molecule. Let me mention that on the molecule the situation is more tricky because there is little expansion. So we can see that the biggest copies of the Mandelbrot set sits on the molecule. So this is a big copy, this is a big copy. So unlike these copies. And sure, moreover, when we are close to the boundary of the main component, then there are strong rotation effects. So I will talk more about this in the second half of my talk. But now I would like to mention a new result, joint work with Misha Lyubich. That there are satellite copies sitting on the molecule, such that the associated canonical homeomorphism is expanding. Namely, we have the MSC, which is the corresponding parameter. So these are first examples of a periodic type on the molecule. And sure, I will also talk a bit later about this, about the ideas of the proof. Now, there is another phenomenon closely related to the MSC called universality. So let us consider this particular small copy of the Mandelbrot set and assume that I is the canonical homeomorphism. Since the MSC holds on the real line, So there is a unique real point, which is a fixed point under R. So this is a fixed point under the canonical homeomorphism. And it turns out that R is a conformal axis R. Conformal in the sense that there is a derivative greater than 1, such that the corresponding linear map approximates homeomorphism with an arrow term. And indeed, if we zoom in, then we see that the Mandelbrot set scales linearly. Let me also mention that when we zoom in, then the Mandelbrot set starts to fill in almost everything. So this was observed by John Milner. So now it's known as fairness theorem. So the Mandelbrot set fills everything when we start to zoom in. So universality was discovered by physicists. So this particular universality was discovered by Feigenbaum in the context of real dynamics. And universality means that the scaling picture is universal, so it's everywhere. And indeed, if we look at other parameter spaces and zoom in at the corresponding parameters, and then zoom in here, then we see the linear scaling. So this particular formula still holds in other parameter spaces, and this constant is the same. So this constant is independent on the parameter space. So universality is explained by means of the renormalization.
That 4.6 is all over the place. Is that what that means?
Oh, yeah.
I see. The same 4.6. So they found it in the numerical experiment from Mercury also. So.
Yeah, so this is a pattern for the renormalization. Briefly speaking, the renormalization is the first return map to a dynamically meaningful subset. So assume that F is a map, assume that this is subset. For a point here, it may happen that it comes back after finitely many iterations. Now, this first return map is the renormalization of F. Of course, we need to choose the subset carefully. And after that, we would like to view renormalization as an operator acting on the space of maps, considered up to some natural conjugacy, usually conformal or affine conjugacy. So let us now go back to the Mandelbrot set. So this is the canonical homeomorphism from this copy to the main set. So this homeomorphism is characterized as follows. So let us consider some point in a small copy of the Mandelbrot set somewhere here. So this is the dynamical plane of this parameter. This is the dynamical plane of its image under the canonical homeomorphism. Now, by definition, this means that the second iterate of this map is conjugate to this map after passing to certain restrictions. So remember that points outside of the non-escaping set escape to infinity. This means that we can choose a small neighborhood of the non-escaping set that maps to a strictly bigger neighborhood. Such object is called a quadratic-like map. And a similar object can be found in the dynamical plane of this map. So the black set here is the small non-escaping set, so it consists of all points that do not escape this smaller domain of the definition under the iteration. So its boundary is a small Julia set, and we can see that this Julia sets are the same. So in fact, there is a quasi-conformal conjugacy between this map and this map, and conformal in the interior. So a quasi-conformality is a convenient weakening of smoothness. In fact, a quasi-conformal map is smooth almost everywhere. So this is the reason why there are infinitely many copies of the Mandelbrot set almost everywhere, that there is this type of renormalization. Let me also mention that the restriction and taking an iteration are true analytic operations. However, quasi-conformal conjugacy is not an analytic operation. So it is natural to split analytic operations from non-analytic operations. So this leads to the following setup. So let us consider the space of all quadratic-like maps up to affine conjugacy. A quadratic-like map is a branch covering from a smaller domain to a bigger domain, such that the degree is 2. So this is a big space of infinite dimension, but it is an analytic space. Now, instead of dealing with the old red arm, we can define a new analytic blue arm, which is just the restriction and iteration. So we restrict the domain of the definition of a quadratic-like map, and we iterate twice. So this defines a partial analytic map from this big analytic space to itself. It is analytic because both operations are analytic. Well, now, as I have said, the dimension of this big space is infinite. However, quasi-conformal conjugacy creates a codimension 1 stable foliation in this big space. So the bifurcation occurs only in the transverse direction.
Complex dimension
1. Yes, complex dimension
1. Transverse direction to what?
To the foliations. So it's going to be another picture. And now, again, one universality follows kind of from the probability picture. So this is the probability picture. So this is, imagine that this is a big space of quadratic-like maps of infinite dimension. Here sits unstable manifold of dimension 1. This is stable manifold of codimension 1. And then this is a slice of quadratic polynomials. It also has dimension 1. And then there is a codimension 1 stable foliation characterized by the properties that two maps in the same leaf are quasi-conformally conjugate and conformally conjugate in the non-escaping set. So meaning that when we go along any leaf, we don't have any bifurcation, and only when we go in the transverse direction, there is bifurcation. Now, the image of the slice of quadratic polynomials is another slice, one-dimensional, that is closer to the unstable manifold. Now, using the holonomy along the foliation, we can bring the image back to the slice of quadratic polynomials. So this way we obtain a map from the slice of quadratic polynomials to itself, which is the old red R, and which is the composition of the new analytic blue R and holonomy. Now the capability of this renormalization combined with holonomy explain and prove plug-in-bound universality. On the unstable manifold, the renormalization is just a linear map, so it is conjugate to a linear map where lambda is greater than 1. On the slice of quadratic polynomials, we have a linear map, but with an arrow term. So
if you had a two-parameter family,
yeah,
would this unstable manifold then be a two-dimensional thing?
Yes, but it's more difficult to work with two-dimensional slices. So people still don't know how to do it. Yes.
But he said two-dimensional family. What do you mean? Family of one-dimensional map? Or a family of two-dimensional map?
I didn't say family, I don't think. I asked if the unstable manifold would be two-dimensional.
Yeah. Yep.
If
you had two parameters instead of just one.
For instance, two parameters, what?
Cubic polynomial.
Cubic polynomial.
Right. Then we should expect that the unstable manifold is has dimension two.
It's probably still it's not linearizable, maybe.
That's one of the equations.
That is not completely true. There are also examples where the instance of manifold has higher dimension.
Yes.
I mean, even if it just has two parameters?
Yeah.
Huh? But it's a holomorphic system?
No.
Well, kind of during this holonomy, we also used the lambda lemma, which is available only when the codimension is 1. So this is another technical issue. So the lambda lemma allows to say that the arrow is of this form. So this was the first universality established in the context of complex dynamics. Historically, it was done in three steps. So Denis Sullivan constructed this fixed point under the normalization. He also showed that there is a convergence in the stable manifold. Dennis Kerr-McMullen shows that the convergence within the stable manifold is exponential. So this means that the normalization is hyperbolic if we restrict to the stable manifold. And Misha Lyubich constructed unstable manifold and codimension 1 field variation and she deduced scaling results. So nowadays, universality is established for many infinitely renormalizable parameters of periodic types. So often when we have the MLC could be promoted to a universality picture around periodic parameters or bounded. Let us now look at another type of the similarity of the Mandelbrot set, namely the self-similarity near the boundary of the main component of the Mandelbrot set. So remember that on the boundary there are strong rotation effects. So let us zoom in at this point. So this point is called traditionally golden Ziegler parameter. I will explain the name a bit later. Now if we zoom in, so we see that the Mandelbrot set scales linearly around this particular parameter. So here is the reason why we should expect such scaling. So a quadratic polynomial has two fixed points, traditionally called alpha and beta, normalized such that 2 alpha is less or equal than 2 beta. So this is the derivative. The fixed point beta is always repellent. But alpha could be attraction. In fact, alpha is attracting exactly when we are inside this main component. So this is one of the characterizations of this main component. For the parameter c equal to 0, the map is just z goes to z square, and alpha is 0, so it attracts everything. And when we move a parameter within this component, alpha remains attracting. But when we cross the boundary, there is a rotation around alpha, so points around alpha tend to rotate. Outside of this black main component, alpha is repelling, but the Julia set still could be connected. So now for rotations we have the following randomization pattern. So let us consider first rotation by end of pi of the unit disk. So I will usually call it E of pi. Let us take some closed internal ray connecting the center of the unit disk to some point on the boundary. say I. And let us delete the closed sector between I and its image. And let us consider the first return map to the remaining space. So this means that we iterate twice on the pre-image of this deleted sector. So this is the pre-image of I. And we iterate once in the remaining part. Now this the map that goes to z to the power 1 over 1 minus pi. Project this first return map to a new rotation. Okay, let us assume that 1 is not in the deleted sector. So then after applying this map, so it glues exactly out of this angle 1 minus pi, it creates the full angle. So we obtain a new rotation. Say by angle R of 5. And we can check that R of 5 is equal to 5 over 1 minus 5 if 5 is between 0 and 1 half. And 2 5 minus 1 over 5 otherwise. So in the first case, we just divide the rotation angle by the remaining angle by 1 minus 5 to obtain this fraction. And for the second case, we can use the symmetry. So this is actually 1 power of the unit circle. And we can check that 3 minus square root of 5 over 2 and square root of 5 minus 1 over 2 form a periodic 2 cycle. So this is the golden ratio. Integers. So a local rotation at this point is exactly 3 minus square root of 5 over 2, which is a golden ratio up to a sign. Well, now we can take this renormalization pattern and insert it to our dynamical plane. So we can choose a curve I, its image, and we can delete the smallest sector between. So I'm ignoring a lot of issues here, but at least locally it is possible to do. And then the result is another map with this rotation number. So it's this periodic cycle. So which means that after doing the second operation, we would come back to this point. So this is the combinatorial reason for the self-similarity at this parameter, because it's true periodic under this renormalization pattern. So in GTR, if we zoom in, so this is the map R square. Now, a similar operation can be performed for other parameters on the boundary of this main component. For example, at this parameter, the local rotation angle is 1 over 3. And now if we do this operation, then out of 1 over 3, we obtain 1 over 2. So the local, we had a local rotation angle 1, 3, and it became local rotation angle 1 half. And similar with other parameters on the boundary of the main component. Now, if we take a parameter here in this limb, then alpha is the repellent. However, since this limb is attached to a parameter with a local rotation number 1 over 3, the non-escaping set has three components that rotate around alpha. And we still can perform, at least combinatorially or topologically, this surgery. By the way, this polynomial is known as the rabbit polynomial. So these are true ES. And we can dynamically delete one of the E. So then we also need to, since now it's not a rotation of the unit disk anymore, so the degree is true, we also need to delete all three images. So we delete here, here, and here, and so on. And then the result is a map from this limb. So it is possible to do the surgery. So it was done by Brown and Douady. So this is a quasi-conformal surgery, meaning that after the operation, we obtain a map that is quasi-conformally conjugate to a map here. And now, using the surgery, we can construct a partial subjective map from this limb to this limb. So every map in this limb has this pattern. So it has three components that rotates around alpha. And this operation creates a map in this limb. So this is a partial map, because after deleting, what could be obtained is that the set becomes disconnected. So if it's disconnected, then it's not in the domain of the definition. So a similar operation could be done for other limbs. So this is one fourth limb. After doing this operation, we obtain a partial map from this limb to this limb, a partial subjective map. So there is a partial subjective map from this limb to this limb. There is a partial subjective map from this limb to the main set, and so on. So for every limb, we can perform this operation. And this way, we obtain a 3-to-1 partial map around the molecule. And it turns out that the molecule is exactly the non-escaping set for this map R. So the molecule consists of the parameters that could be iterated infinitely many times under this molecule map. So this is the this map incorporates rotation effects on the boundary of the main component. And essentially, this is a complexification of this map. So on the set of rotations, we had a 2-to-1 map. And if we complexify, then we obtain a 3-to-1 map, because roughly there is like an extra critical point. And this map is responsible for self-similarity of the Mandelbrot set near the boundary of the main component. So this map is modeled by this cubic polynomial. So this cubic polynomial and its non-escaping set has the same dynamics as the molecule map. So if the MNC holds, then these maps are just conjugate. If MNC doesn't hold, then there is a semi-conjugation from this map to this map.
Is it quasi-conformal?
Not for free. So by default, it's a continuous map. So to study its geometric properties, we need to do some renormalization theory. So now we know that it's kind of nice, conformal at certain places, but only at certain places. But yes, to study regularity of this map, we introduce an object called a Pacman. So a Pacman is a 2-to-1 map from a smaller domain to a strictly bigger domain, such that the map has one critical arc, gamma 1. So gamma 1 has three images. And these two pre-images get viewed. So the name comes from all good times. I'm not sure if it's available anymore.
It's available. You can even set your Google Maps to eat dots as you drive along the path.
Okay. We should try. So the definition itself mimics the definition of a quadratic-like map. However, a major technical issue is that it's not a branch covering. So if you take a point slightly below gamma bound, then it has two pre-images. One is here, and another is here. So a point on the critical arc gamma bound has three pre-images, one here, and one here. So 1, 2, 3. Entry point slightly above gamma 1 has again two pre-images, but one of the pre-images is going to be here. So in other words, when we cross gamma 1, then one of the pre-images jumps. So this is not a branch covering, and it creates many technical issues. Nevertheless, it still has some nice external structure, and we can work with such object.
If you glue the two edges together,
you obtain a quadratic-like map. But then the gluing is a quasi-conformal operation.
I see.
So we wanted to study analytic property of the randomization, and then quasi-conformality would be encoded in the polynomial. So a Pacman is renormalizable if the image of gamma 1 is disjoint from gamma 1 and this curve. So this is gamma 2, which is the image of gamma 1. And now, if a Pacman is renormalizable, then we can delete this sector between gamma 1 and gamma 2. And we iterate twice on this sector. So in this renormalization, we mimic this pattern. So this is the result of the renormalization. Under the renormalization, many orbits become shorter, which is the point of the randomization. Now, let me illustrate how it works on rabbits. So this is a Pacman, and the black set illustrates its non-escaping set. So we should think that this Pacman is conjugate to the rabbit polynomial after appropriate restriction. Or, saying it differently, we can do some surgery that glues this boundary curves into one arc. Well, now, when we do the randomization, we obtain this kind of Pacman, and this corresponds to the result of Brunner DOD surgery. So this operation is analytic, and the purpose is to encode kind of the essence of Brunner DOD surgery. Well, now, the theorem, so it was a joint work with Misha Lyubich and Nikita Selinger, that for periodic parameters of this map, we can construct a corresponding hyperbolic analytic Pacman randomization operator. So namely, we have this picture with a one-dimensional unstable manifold and two-dimensional unstable manifold. There would be a slice of quadratic polynomials here. There would be a periodic Pacman here, and so on. So we have a hyperbolic picture for every periodic parameters of this map.
Would you still have your foliation also?
Not for free. So since a Pacman is not a branch covering, we can't use the same technology how it was done for quadratic-like maps. So we do construct foliation a little bit differently. I will talk briefly in 5 minutes. Before, two remarks that periodic points for a cylinder randomization were constructed by Kirk McMullen in the 1990s. So a cylinder randomization is a localized version of a Pacman randomization. And after that, the probabilistic question was open for approximately 20 years. So another remark is that in Shishikura obtained probabilistic for the cylinder randomization for high type parameters. So these are parameters that are in the small neighborhood of the past, while our parameters are away from small neighborhood of the past. So these are two complementary cases. So they obtained using probabilistic using perturbative methods. Namely, they proved that the limiting randomization, the limiting parabolic randomization that corresponds to the past is hyperbolic, and since a hyperbolic condition is open, there is also probabilistic for nearby parameters. So these are parameters, these are complementary cases, and indeed if we zoom in, so this is zoom in of the past, and if we zoom in a little bit further, then we see that the Mandelbrot set has this structure, so it's called, they are called elephants, so it's like one elephant going after another. So this is the behavior at the past. While the scaling of the Mandelbrot set near zero parameters has this picture. So it's two different behaviors of the Mandelbrot set near the past. Well, another corollary of the probability picture is that a stable manifold could be viewed as a limiting picture of the Mandelbrot set. So roughly speaking, a zoomed picture of the Mandelbrot set near the periodic parameters is an approximation of the unstable manifold, and maps on the unstable manifold are naturally transcendental. So a stable manifold could be studied as a transcendental family. So what is important in our work is that, first of all, this white space disappears in the limit, and then what is left are some curves. And what is important for our work is to understand these curves and use these curves to construct certain partitions of the unstable manifold. This is the main part of our new work. And it allows to construct a stable lamination as follows. So using methods of transcendental dynamics and some ideas, we recognize a certain map on the unstable manifold. Then we can do a small perturbation and construct a small local leaf around a map that we recognize. So it's going to be a codimension one leaf. And now we can run randomization. So namely, we can take pre-images of this small local leaf. And this way, we can create a fairly dense lamination near the stable manifold. And now, once we have a lamination, we can combine holonomy with the probability of randomization R. So namely, we can map the size of quadratic polynomials using the randomization, and then using holonomy bring the slice back and obtain scaling results for the slice of quadratic polynomials. Again, on the unstable manifold we have the linear scaling, on the slice of quadratic polynomials we have a linear scaling but with an error term.
Don't you need the leaves of this foliation to go all the way?
Well, yeah, they would go all the way up to here. Well, maybe not this one, but the next one, and then the one after the next one. So we would obtain scaling along these leaves, not along the leaves that don't go all the way.
See, so you have to take a smaller
leaf. Yeah, so we need to take a small neighborhood, right? So as a result, we can actually verify the scaling property of the Mandelbrot set near the boundary of the main component for certain C. So with the expanding constant lambda greater than 1. So this this picture that has been absorbed by doing experiments could be actually verified. And then as a consequence, we can also find a sequence of small copies of the Mandelbrot set that scales near this parameter. And this causes this canonical homeomorphism to be expanding. Namely, instead of mapping this small copy of the Mandelbrot set directly to the main copy, we can first use the scaling and map it, for example, somewhere here. And then we do scaling many, many times. So during the scaling, we accumulate a huge expansion, lambda to the power n. And then only on the last map, we can use some homeomorphism to map this copy to the Mandelbrot set. And now, since if n is sufficiently big, then this component makes the composition expanding. So this is how we can verify that this homeomorphism is expanding, and as a consequence, we have to associate the corresponding parameter. So now, to summarize, there are three renormalization theories for the Mandelbrot set. Primitive renormalization deals quite well with the parameters that are away from the molecule. So it works quite well with primitive small copies. Neoparabolic renormalization consorts the parameters that are in some small neighborhood of the path. And Pacman renormalization consorts neighborhoods of periodic parameters on the boundary of the main component. Well, hopefully this theories would merge, and the unified theory would be able to describe completely the topology and geometry of the Mandelbrot set. Okay, let me stop here. Thank you.
I have a weird question. Is this question possibly? I mean, there's so many different landscapes, uncountably many, maybe. Right. So maybe it's not decidable.
You mean the MSC or?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how to answer. Okay. Well, for now, what people do is to try to analyze different phenomena in different parts of the Mandelbrot set so that to gain complete picture and then try to merge.
Right.
But for now, it's sort of, this philosophically is almost impossible to imagine some. Rooms where something can go wrong.
So here when you say unified theory, you mean you want to have one theory that explains all three of these, for instance?
Yes. So unified theory that incorporates this global map from all small copies of the Mandelbrot set to the main Mandelbrot set. So to prove the MSC, we need to show that all canonical homeomorphisms are simultaneously expanding. So in particular, we need to sort of allow to iterate different renormalizations. So this means that, iteration, this renormalization and then iterating some other renormalization don't break the picture.
If you need the Pacman renormalization near the single points, which points do you need the Pacman?
Well, kind of ideally, it should explain the molecule map. So this is designed to understand the geometry of the molecule map. So currently, we can understand what's going on in neighborhoods of Ziegler parameters, of periodic Ziegler parameters, or of bounded parameters. So this is where we understand quite well what's going on. Well, one also may want to understand parameters that are of mixed type, so a little bit of this combinatorics, a little bit of that combinatorics, a little bit maybe of inbound combinatorics. But for now, we can understand only what's going on near Ziegler parameters.
How dense are the Ziegler parameters?
Well, kind of everywhere. Well, there are dense parameters on this main component, and this is the one that we study, but any other component is equivalent to this component. So in particular, there are the corresponding Ziegler parameters on this component, and there is a corresponding scaling, and then there are Ziegler parameters on any other component, and then there is also the corresponding scaling. So once you construct one map, then sort of the twins are everywhere dense on the boundary of the Mandelbrot set. So therefore people restrict the attention to just the main component, and other components are just equivalent.
Isn't the finite form renormalization different from all these three?
Fabian-bound renormalization is a satellite renormalization, so it's different from the primitive renormalization. But then Fabian-bound parameter is on the real line, and then methods from real dynamics can help. So it's not that the Fabian-bound fibers can intersect the real line only at a single point. But yeah, you can say that it's a little bit different from these free renormalizations. So it's...
Yeah, I beg you to recall that if MLC is true, that there's some construction of Thurston that would give a model for this set. You take the circle and collapse subsets that are varying at z equals to z squared.
You were talking about that in the beginning.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, so there is a pinch disk model. So too fast. Right. Yeah, so if the MLC holds, then the Mandelbrot set is a continuous image of the closed unit disk.
And what do you collapse exactly?
So we draw randomly many leaves in a prescribed manner. So there is an algorithm how to draw the leaves. So we connect 1-3 and 2-3. So this corresponds to this cut point. We connect 1-7 and 2-7. This corresponds to this point. We connect 5-7 and 6-7. This corresponds to this point. Then on the next step, we run through all rational maps of the form n over 15, and then we connect whatever we can connect. So we connect 1.15 with 2.15, it's going to be somewhere here. So we then connect 3.15 with 4.15, it's going to be here. So 5.15 is 1 over 3, so it's already done. Then 6.15, we cannot connect here. But then we kind of must connect here and so on. So there is kind of an algorithm how to proceed, and on each step you obtain much more leaves that becomes denser and denser. And now if we draw all leaves, then we obtain lamination, and then we take the closure and collapse. And the result is the Mandelbrot set. So this is a complete continuous map from the unit disk to the Mandelbrot set, provided that the MLC holds.
So that becomes a constructible thing.
Yes.
Okay. So we think, can you hear again?